Up next on Carib Nation, we are discussing gender-based violence and gender equality across the Caribbean diaspora. We're going to have two experts who are giving us an update on where we stand in the Caribbean diaspora and what we need to be doing to really come to a space where we're challenging the status quo and addressing violence against women in our region.
When America wants to know what's happening in the Caribbean diaspora, there is one clear choice.
Hello, welcome to Carib Nation.
Both people inside and outside are
very excited about today's program.
Looking at you, I can tell that you have traveled the journey.
One television organization brings America close to the people, stories, and events that affects Caribbean life. Get close, get answers, get Carib Nation.
Welcome to Carib Nation. My name is Abby Charles and I'm your host this afternoon as we discuss gender-based violence and gender equality across the Caribbean diaspora. We're joined today by Dr. Donna Baird, social scientist and adjunct professor at the University of Maryland University College and president of the Global Center for Behavioral Health. She's also the chair for the Caribbean Conference on Domestic Violence and Gender Equality. And we're also joined by Joseph Vess, senior program officer at Promundo. Founded in 1997, Instituto Promundo is a Brazilian NGO that seeks to address gender violence and promote gender equality among women, children, and youth. Tonight, you know, violence against women continues to be an epidemic globally and across the Caribbean diaspora. From trafficking of women and girls, bride burning, female genital mutilation, rape, intimate partner violence, and sexual harassment, we hear stories daily about the abuses that women and girls face, violations of their human rights. And I'm going to read something from His Excellency Dr. Edwin Carrington, who was the then Secretary General of CARICOM in 2005. And he said, "Persistent stereotypical attitudes towards women continue to pose a challenge to achieving gender equality in the Caribbean. The stresses and vulnerabilities faced by women as a result of HIV, the persistent scourge of violence against women, the risks associated with the pursuit of transactional sex, and the plague of gender-related poverty are some of the prevalent social issues that negatively impact on the quality of life for women of the region. Insufficient access to or control of economic resources and continuous low levels of participation in decision-making processes, including representation in governments, continue to hamper women's advancement and in so doing will have implications for the community's development. There has never been a greater need or opportunity for us to improve gender equality and reduce gender-based violence in our communities. We have technology and we have access to innovative resources to transition this. Tonight we're going to discuss this further and think of how can we really address the status quo in our region and end these violations to our human rights and especially to women's rights. So, you know, I'll ask both of our guests and anyone who wants to answer first, how do you define gender-based violence?
Well, it's defined as an act, any act, towards women in a domestic relationship, an intimate relationship that brings about physical, sexual, financial, and psychological harm. Mm-hmm. Whether intentional or unintentional.
Yeah. And Joseph, do you have a different definition or?
No, I would just add to that that, you know, we also know from experience that gender-based violence can happen against men. It can happen because of homophobia, prejudice towards transgender individuals as well. And mm-hmm. so the problem of gender-based violence, I think, most afflicts women, but it is a burden that is borne by all different kinds of people.
Yeah, thank you so much for reminding us of that. And, you know, Dr. Baird, Tell us a little bit about your work and why violence against women is a concern to you.
Well, you know, as a clinician in the area here in the Washington, D.C. area, and I've also worked in New York, I've worked with individuals that have come in as victims, young girls. Mm-hmm. And I tell you, there's never been a situation where I've worked with a client who was relating his or her story that didn't move me.
Yeah.
Just the basic violation of someone's humanness. Mm-hmm. It's very moving. It really gets you to thinking that you need to get involved, mm-hmm. that something has to be done. Mm-hmm. And it took me back to days as a child in the Caribbean and remembering situations there as a child growing up in my community, within my family, mm-hmm. that were violations mm-hmm. against women primarily.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Dr. Baird and Joe, why should violence against women be a concern for all of us?
Well, I think it's something that affects all of us, either directly or indirectly. I mean, mm-hmm. obviously, when we're talking about the violence that's committed against women, mm-hmm. that's more than 50% of the world's population. But even for men who may feel that it's not an issue for them, we all have countless women in our lives, mm-hmm. even mm-hmm. just our mothers, sisters, wives, daughters, mm-hmm. people like that. And I think there are a number of aspects to gender-based violence that negatively impact men as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's the psychological well-being of individuals is very important here. Mm-hmm. And for women as well as for men and children, we want to improve the well-being, improve the conditions of people's family lives, of communities, mm-hmm. so that it's more holistic, so it's a better place to live, so that a home is a better environment for children to growing.
You know, what does the data tell us? What do statistics tell us about violence against women in the Caribbean? Is there data out there? What does that look like?
Caribbean-specific data, I think we're still collecting, mm-hmm. and so we'll be able to report out on those. I know the CARICOM, there is some information that they just completed data collection in several countries in mm-hmm. the region, and the gender justice advocate mm-hmm. is that person should be preparing a report mm-hmm. that we should have some information soon. I know organizations such as PAHO, World Health, mm-hmm. The CDC have all been working with agencies in the region to try to build capacity with regard to gender analysis mm-hmm. and data collection. Okay. But what we do know based on some of the statistics globally and even here in the US is that about 1 in 3 women, for example,
yeah.
experience violence. Mm-hmm. We know that about $8.2 billion that violence or across the board cost the U.S. about $8.2 billion annually. Mm-hmm. So having that information for the region, I think, would be very important in trying to improve strategies, programs, and in just informing us on what's mm-hmm. happening in the region.
Mm-hmm. Wow, you said 1 in 3?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. And I also read somewhere that, you know, there's 3 of our Caribbean islands are among the top 10 in the world for reported incidences of rape.
Yeah.
So violence against women is a challenge, but I'm curious about why there's gaps in data. Why do you think we don't have enough information on how much violence against women takes place in the region and maybe internationally as well?
Well, I think one of the reasons is funding, is yeah. that there are still too many places and too many countries where this has just not been identified enough as a priority mm-hmm. for organizations to devote time and money to that in comparison to other priorities that they have. I think that's one reason. And another one is it can be difficult to measure as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're often asking people very sensitive questions about traumatic events in their lives mm-hmm. and people are not always very well equipped to go doing that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, and I could imagine, you know, if I were in a situation of violence, maybe not necessarily feeling confident enough to go to police, who often are also male, and I might be afraid to report too because of especially in a very male-dominated society, that may also affect whether, as a woman individually, I would report a case. But you know, Joe, I'd love to hear more about Promundo and the work that you are doing to address gender-based violence.
Okay. Well, we have a couple of major program areas, and one of them is touching on what you just mentioned in terms of the research. Promundo, along with another number of other organizations, has been carrying out the International Men and Gender Equality Survey. And so this is a household survey among men and women in countries all over the world, looking at men's attitudes, behaviors, history, ideals, goals related to gender and gender equality and gender-related issues. So even things like health issues, alcohol and substance abuse that may not be directly related to gender, it would seem, but have connections to that. And then we also do program implementation and support and evaluation throughout the world. Historically, as a Brazilian organization, most of our program work has been in Rio, but in Brazil, but we have worked with organizations throughout the world. We've implemented one of our curricula, Program H, in 24 countries around the world, and it's been, elements of that have been used in even more. And then the final part of our work is international advocacy. So Promundo is one of the co-chairs of the International Men Engage Alliance, which works to mobilize men and bring organizations together to build and develop skills and capacity and raise international awareness about engaging men around a wide variety of topics.
Yeah. So as you talk about men, we've seen increasingly men becoming involved in addressing gender-based violence. But then I talk to some of my friends and they say, that's a woman's problem, right? You know, why is it important for men to be involved in addressing gender-based violence?
Well, men share the lives or share the home environment, the community, they're in the work environment. And so they affect the policies. Right. They help to set the agendas. And so we need them on board. You know, we need the men on board to help raise our children so that they grow up in an environment that's more gender neutral or more tolerant of each other. Or similarities or differences. You know, men have a voice in this process, and we have to also remember that men are victims too. It's or environment or society, there's this macho-ness that men are supposed to be, you know, the tough guys. They don't cry, they're macho. And so that being said, that's one of the ways in which we reinforce the stereotypes. But we're trying to change these behaviors, change these mindsets, and to do that, you have to have men on board.
Yeah, and I would just add that the traditional and stereotypical gender norms that lead to gender-based violence, that lead to violence against women, are in many cases really harmful and destructive to men themselves. One of the things that comes up a lot in this discussion is men's health and men's health behaviors, so things like going to the doctor. And we know that part of the same attitudes that lead men to not go to the doctor, that lead men to not seek help, that lead men to engage in risky sexual behaviors are the same kind of male dominant attitudes that lead men to commit violence against women. And so having these attitudes is really not serving anyone. It's not serving women, and it's definitely not serving men either.
So what are some of the things that are driving these attitudes? What are the structural causes? You know, violence against women persists even though we know it's a violation. We know it's a human rights wrong. What are some of those structural factors that make it the status quo or make it normal for it to exist internationally?
There's discussion that it starts at birth. And so as we raise children, we ourselves, women, and the fathers or husbands in a home, we ourselves, we reinforce these behaviors. So it really has to start in the home. And then as children move into the school environment, we need the schools to be sensitive to the way in which children are instructed, the way they're guided in the school environment, to make sure that it's a gender neutral environment. Mm-hmm. And then you move into areas such as the workplace. We move into the church, which is a big piece in the Caribbean region, or religious codes. Mm-hmm. And so all sectors have a role to play and in reinforcing these mm-hmm. stereotypes. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And I think the other driver that when we get to a very deep level is a sense of male privilege, yeah. is a feeling among men that we deserve to be in charge, we deserve to act in ways that are dominant over women. And I think those attitudes in many cases are so deeply ingrained that we don't even think about them on a day-to-day basis. And it's particularly difficult as well for a lot of men because we may not feel privileged in certain aspects of our life based on socioeconomic class, based on race, based on any number of other things. But we still, really all of us, live in countries in which male supremacy is a part of life in terms of the number of men who are elected representatives, heads of corporations, right. Things like that.
Yeah. So, our media, our cultures, I'm from Trinidad, so we have Carnival, where it's fine for a guy to just come and whine on a woman at any time. Some people see that as violence. Some people see that as non-violence. But I'm curious, how do you transform a culture, right, when this is part and ingrained in our societies? How do you begin to do that?
I think education okay. is the way to do it. That's not the only way, but I think that's the main place that you start mm-hmm. in terms of changing cultures and changing the way people think about this. And, mm-hmm. and as Dr. Baird was saying, you want to start at the earliest possible age. Mm-hmm. And what would it look like if we were able to do this kind of education in schools, in churches, yeah. in neighborhoods, yeah. in community centers, all of these different kinds of places where men would get role modeling from other men around these issues and see how positive it is. Mm-hmm. And I think it's hard to imagine what that change would look like in mm-hmm. so many years, but we've already made a lot of progress, I think. And mm-hmm. When you look at issues like seatbelt usage or smoking and things like that in many countries, 50 years ago it would be inconceivable that everyone would wear a seatbelt, and now it's almost uniform.
Very true, very mm-hmm. true. So, Dr. Baird, you talked about gender neutral. And I think when people talk about addressing gender equality and creating an equal space, some people say, oh, you're trying to create a woman's world, right? What does a gender neutral world look like?
It's just an acceptance and of each other uh-huh. and the differences mm-hmm. in what we each bring to the table. It's not trying to encourage a male to be more female mm-hmm. or vice versa. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. just each person understanding that we all have strengths and weaknesses. We have special talents. Mm-hmm. And as we implement programs, we do them in a manner that is respectful of the strengths and weaknesses of each gender.
And as you both have been doing your work, what are some of the successes that you've seen? Because we hear so much negative, but what are some of the successes that we've seen in addressing gender-based violence internationally, but also in the Caribbean?
I think definitely, speaking about the Caribbean specifically, the conversations have been happening.
Ah.
I attended a meeting there in October, which was a transformational women's leadership meeting. And there were men there. Mm-hmm. And there was a gentleman that stood up and said, I am excited to be here, and I am glad to lend my voice to this discussion. Mm-hmm. So the conversations are happening. We need to continue having the discussions. We know that some of the reports that I looked at, places like St. Lucia pass an Equal Pay Act.
Awesome.
We have recently, for the 16 days to end violence against women, we had places like Barbados that had a program and they called it Walk a Mile in Her Shoe. Mm. We had Aspire in Trinidad did a respectful relationships campaign. So there's work being done. And so it's having also organizations such as UN Women mm-hmm. and PAHO with its gender profile and CARICOM with its gender portfolio all playing a part is very good.
Awesome. You made me smile with that one. Like, I'm really excited about what's happening. But, you know, Joseph, any successes?
Well, you know, there's more and more every year grassroots campaigns and programs that are engaging men and boys in a wide variety of different ways. I mean, the White Ribbon Campaign is in something like 70 or 80 different countries. There are so many programs that have been implemented and have been evaluated and have found to be, been found to be effective in bringing these more positive norms out. And you know, one of the things that, that always makes me happy is, you know, here in the U.S. we see President Obama, who, you know, for Sexual Assault Awareness Month and Domestic Violence Awareness Month, is speaking out about how this is important. And even the way that he role models a very, what it seems to be at least, a very gender equitable relationship with his with his wife and the way that they raise their daughters. I think that he's a tremendous role model for all of us and kind of how a man can live a more gender equitable life and challenge gender-based violence.
Right, and you know, as you talk about that, you speak about leaders, right? And the leaders, I guess, have to reflect this as well in order to change that culture, as we talked about earlier. But what about the challenges? What is, what are these barriers? What are some of the challenges that you face as you do this work?
Well, you know, you mentioned leadership, which is so important. And I must say that in the Caribbean, we have two female prime ministers, Trinidad and Tobago and Jamaica. So we've made some advance. I also, in Trinidad and Tobago, we, the prime minister appointed two special envoys on for women and girls. And so they have been very active in the communities, speaking on behalf of women and girls and training communities, women in communities on different initiatives that UN Women has. So those are some of the things that, that's very important to say. But I think some of the challenges remain for us because we're now getting a lot of programs on board. We're in the process of reviewing policies to see what which ones are good and which ones we need to revise. So there are challenges. There's always challenge in behavior change. That's fundamental. People are used to doing what they've done, and we're working to change the way they understand gender-based violence, domestic violence, and it, the impact on others, the impact on themselves. So, and I think also what's very important to the region is the law enforcement piece. We really, really need to have some focus on that, that when women are violated, or if men are violated, or if young children are violated, that the law enforcement is active in pursuing, prosecuting the perpetrators.
Okay. So the year is 2040, and we have a community where we've eliminated gender-based violence. What did it take for us to get there?
A lot of hard work.
Okay.
But focused, a model that included a very integrated approach.
Okay.
So we have, you know, the schools, the court system, you know, treatment providers, the whole spectrum, research involved, working together, collaborating with each other to really make this happen, and sharing the information with each other, sharing the information with the community, allowing the community to be a part of the discussion to help shape how we go about doing things. Because if we don't have that cultural context, for example, or specific community involvement, we might totally miss the curve. So we want everyone involved in helping to really shape the dialogue and shape the programs that, that are implemented.
Okay.
I think to accomplish that by 2040, two things that come to mind for me are men really need to internalize this. We need to realize that we're not doing this because this is a women's issue or because somebody else told us to. We're doing this because it's the right thing to do. It's better for us. It's better for everyone. And the other thing that I would say is that we have to realize that, you know, changing gender inequitable attitudes and getting to a place of gender equality and then maintaining that, it's not kind of a thing like a vaccination where you take a pill once and then you're good. It's you have to take the vitamin every single day, you know, and so the kind of programs that we put in place, the kind of education that we do, it's not as if we can say, you know, okay, you took this class for a year and that's it. It needs to be really sustained, and it needs to be integrated into national curriculums and education programs for years and years and years, and we can't take it away then after a few years. It's got to be there for the long haul so that we can maintain that positive place.
So as we close, one thing that our audience can do to address gender-based violence, one thing today.
Start the discussion with your kids. Really have the conversations in the home environment with our daughters, with our sons, in shaping their thinking, restructuring their thinking on violence and towards each other, and violence as it affects the community.
Got it. Got it.
Yeah, mine's very similar. I mean, men need to start thinking about this and talking about this. They need to be talking about it with women to learn about it from them and to get their perspectives, and they need to then talk about it with other men. Their kids, they need to talk about it with men in all of the communities that they're a part of, and really start challenging and holding each other accountable.
Yeah. So you've heard it tonight. We've gotten the solutions. We've heard what we need to do to work better together to get to that space where we've eliminated gender-based violence and created gender equality in our communities. You've gotten a task. Go talk to your children. Talk to them about what it means to be equal in our homes, in our schools, and then start challenging our policymakers to create those laws that creates gender equality in our communities. We can do it. We can create a world where we have no violence against women. A violence-free life is our right, it's women's rights, and it's all of our human rights. So let's work towards that. Thank you so much for viewing. Thank you, audience. But as well, I'd like to thank our guests this evening, Joe Vess, Senior Program Manager at Promundo, and Dr. Donna Baird, president of the Global Center for Behavioral Health. Thank you so much for participating, and thank you for your insight and knowledge. It's been truly appreciated. Thank you very much. Again, my name is Abby Charles, coming from Carib Nation. We are one people, one culture, one Caribbean, one nation. Thank you very much.